Hi there folks, in today's demonstration I'm going to show you how we can duplicate a template parent flow. So what do I mean by that? Well, if you are using parents and childs in solutions and for whatever reason you're trying to deliver that parent across multiple SharePoint sites, maybe multiple lists, when a selected item is created, when a file is created, you will know that as you commission new sites and new lists that you need to then go and build another version of that parent flow. Well, in today's demonstration, I'm going to look at one possible way to commission a parent flow based on a new site or a new list. We can pass in some dynamic values and then copy a template parent and add that flow to our solution, turning it on so that it's immediately ready to use in our environment. Now, if that's something that interests you, please make sure you like and subscribe. And without further ado, let's jump into the demonstration. So I'm going to kick things off from within inside my solution here. I have several flows. I've got a parent flow as a template and then a couple of instances of that parent flow for different SharePoint sites and lists. And then I have a child flow. So if we pop open the parent flow, we can see it's a very basic solution. It literally is a parent with a trigger based on my SharePoint site one. I have a list name which is issue tracker, and then I'm running a child flow, and to that child flow I'm passing the SharePoint URL, the list GUID which is unique to each list, and then the ID of the item that of course has triggered this flow. Jumping back onto the solution, if I pop open my child, we can see that we have a manual trigger that accepts that SharePoint site, the list GUID and the ID of the item. I'm then getting that item using those values that I've passed in dynamically, and I'm sending an email to myself to let me know that a new item has been added on a list, and of course here is a link to that particular item before responding back to that flow. Now this might not seem like an overly complex solution, it isn't really. What I'm trying to demonstrate here is how we can then duplicate that parent flow and update the values of the trigger. So if we look back at that parent flow, it's the site address, which in this case is SharePoint site one. I want to update that to any site that I've created so I can very quickly roll out this parent flow to multiple sites and multiple lists. And you might use that for approvals or other core functionality where you're building out flows across multiple sites. So it's a case of build it once, use a parent that you can then duplicate programmatically using Power Automate in this case. And that's ultimately what I want to demo to you in today's session. Okay, so we've already seen the basic parent-child flow scenario. I'm in my SharePoint site here. And if I go ahead and create a new item on this issue tracker list on my SharePoint site 5 and hit save, that should trigger the parent for my SharePoint site 5 and then send me an email. Jumping over into my email, I can pop open this newly received link here that says I've added an item into the list on SharePoint 5 with ID 6. And if I click on that link, it's going to pop open that brand new item that I've just created. So that's based on a flow that already exists in my solution. What about now if I go ahead and create a brand new SharePoint site? Now, if I go into SharePoint and create a new site, we'll create a team site. I'll call this SharePoint Site 365, go to next, finish off that wizard, and here I have my brand new SharePoint site. And of course, there'll be no flows attached to this site. I also don't have any lists, so I'm gonna go into new list. I'll choose the issue tracker, use that template, but rather than call it issue tracker, let's call it my issue list. And we'll go ahead and create that. So with this now in place, I have a new SharePoint site, I have a new list, and I'm not using the default name for that list. If I pop open my flow now that I've built that's going to allow me to duplicate the parent flow and also update all the dynamic values, I'm going to put this into test mode, and later on I'll explain how this all works. So into manual, there are three parameters that I've asked for. The first is the SharePoint URL, and of course I can copy that from here and paste that in. The second is the list name, and I've called that my issue list. And the final parameter is what would I like that new flow to be called. So I'm going to call it the parent flow for SharePoint site 365. And we'll go ahead and run that flow. So the flow will go ahead and grab the ID for that new list. It'll then go and grab the list template from that solution. We'll then get what's called the client data, which is basically the flow definition. And with that, I'm making changes to swap out some of the GUIDs and some of the dynamic content. And then creating the flow, I'm getting the ID of that newly created flow, adding it to a solution, and then finally turning it on. Now, if we jump back onto that SharePoint site where that newly created list is, if I go into new, I can go and create a new item on list 365. We can save that, and that should trigger the newly created parent that we've just created using that other flow I've just demonstrated. If I jump onto my email, where I've been welcomed to my new SharePoint site 365 group, we will hear a ping, and we can see that we've created a new item on our SharePoint site 365 with the item ID 1, because of course this is a brand new list. And if I click on that link like I did before for the SharePoint site 5, you'll see this has taken me to my SharePoint site 365 and opened up that brand new list item. If I jump back onto my solution, you'll see at the moment that I don't have my parent flow for 365. That's because it needs a refresh. But if I go into this filter here for cloud flows, it's already detected that this parent flow for 365 has been created. And if I jump back to all, we can see a quick refresh that's happened there, and our parent flow for SharePoint site 365 has now been added. If I open that up, we can see it was successfully run just 1 minute ago when I created that new item. I didn't need to turn it on. I didn't need to make any changes. And if I go into edit and pop open that trigger when an item is created on that SharePoint site for 365 using my issue list, which is the name of that issue tracker, we'll run a child flow, which of course will pass in the URL for the SharePoint site 365, the GUID, which is a GUID for that specific issue list, and then of course the dynamic ID, which just comes from the trigger anyway. So with that, I've demonstrated how you can create a parent flow using a template parent flow. It gets added to an existing solution, which happens to be unmanaged. It's impossible to add a flow into an existing managed solution, but we have updated all the dynamic content within the trigger and also the action to run the child flow, and very quickly delivered a template flow to a brand new SharePoint site with a completely different, uniquely named SharePoint list. So let's go and explore the flow that creates this flow in more detail. So to explain this in more detail, I have the flow history open up on the left-hand side and then the flow in edit on the right-hand side. The trigger should be self-explanatory. I have three parameters. I'm asking for that SharePoint URL, the list name, and then the new flow name, which is the name of the newly created flow. Next up, I'm using the send an HTTP request to SharePoint, and I'm taking the URL from the trigger, and I'm using the get method in order to retrieve the GUID of the newly created list. You'll see the list name is passed in here dynamically. And with that, I can obtain the GUID of that new SharePoint list. And there's the expression on screen. So if I look at the history on the left-hand side, we're sending an HTTP request to that 365 site based on that list name, which is my issue list. And then if I pop open the compose, you'll see that I've retrieved the GUID based on that API call to SharePoint. Next up, I'm using the invoke an HTTP request, which is an Azure AD connector. And the joys with this particular connector is that you can authenticate with loads of different services. And in this case, I'm authenticating to the web API. Now you can do an app registration and therefore use the HTTP action, the familiar green HTTP action, which is premium, but you can also authenticate and do everything via this particular action if you're using a user or a service account. Now, before I get started talking about this particular action and the API that I'm using, I've fired up the documents on screen here, how you can work with Cloud Flows using code. There is the web API, lots of different examples here in the documentation, which I'll include in the description. And it's ultimately this that I'm using in order to create and duplicate and turn on the flows and add them into solutions. You don't have to use Power Automate. You could use PowerShell, but of course I love Power Automate, and so I had no other option but to build a cloud flow to do this. If we look at how to connect, you need to provide the URL for your environment, which you can get from the Power Platform Admin Center, and then you tag on API data version 9.2 and anything else that you want to do based on the samples you have on this documentation. When you want to create a connection, it's slightly different from normal. If I go into add new connection, You'll see that you need to specify the base URL and the Azure AD resource URI. Well, both of them are exactly the same. They are the URL that you take from your environment. I've already got that set up, so I'll cancel, and we'll now look at what this action actually does. So you can see that I have a GET method, I have an API call here, I'm filtering workflows based on a name, and that particular name is my template. So the template flow in my solution is called parent flow-template, and with that filter, I'm able to get back the ID of that template. If we look at the history on the left-hand side, there's the input, get the workflow based on the parent flow template. And if we scroll down, we can see the GUID of that particular flow. But there's also some very useful information in here called client data, which is your flow definition. And so we can see, if I highlight there, the flow definition, it is a JSON string. And in there are the connection references, there are all the actions, there are all the parameters. So as I work my way from left to right now, we can see what is contained within my flow. We can see the trigger when an item is created. We can see how that trigger is set up. We can see the site that it's triggering on, which is SharePoint Site 1, the table, which is Issue Tracker. And of course, it's all these values that I'm going to replace in this client data so that I update the SharePoint Site 1 with SharePoint Site 365. I update the Issue Tracker with the new list tracker that I've created, that new name that I've created. And then there's also a GUID later on in this flow that references the SharePoint list. And in fact, I think this might be it here. And I do a find and replace with the GUID that I've got from the compose list GUID so that the GUID that's passed the child flow is relevant to the newly created list on that SharePoint site. So that's what leads me on to this next action, which is a compose action. And in there I have what looks like a rather complex replace, but it's a nested replace. I'm replacing three different values. First up, I'm replacing that SharePoint site, which is the SharePoint site 1, with the text that's passed the trigger, which is the SharePoint site 365, so the dynamic value for the site. Then I'm replacing the GUID with the old GUID and the new GUID. And then I'm replacing the word issue tracker, which is the name of the list in my parent, with the value that I provided in the trigger. And that gives us an updated flow definition. Next up is all logical. We're gonna create that flow, we're gonna get the ID of that flow, add it to a solution and turn it on. And we just have a series of more API calls. We have a post, which is going to create that new flow. And it's here that we pass in the client data, which is that JSON string that contains those updated values. We have the option of specifying a name, which is why I capture the new flow name as part of the trigger. And I also have the option of description. Into the next action, which is getting the ID. Similar to the first example in the flow, we're simply getting the flow, but this time based on the new flow name. And that will allow us to get the GUID back, which we then need to subsequently use in the add to a solution. So here we're posting to the add solution component API, again with some more parameters, the component ID, which in this case is the workflow ID from the action above. We have component type, which is quite interesting. So component type 29 is a cloud flow, but you can add environment variables and all sorts of different components into your solutions using this API. So lots of potential there. Some other parameters, and then finally the unique name of the solution where I'm adding in this new flow. And it's worth noting at this point that this is not the display name of the solution, it is the name, so the internal name of the solution. The final request is a patch, and all we're doing here is taking that workflow ID again, and we're patching to this endpoint and changing the state code, which is draft or turned off when this flow is first created, to state code 1, which means that the flow is now turned on, ready for action. And that's why I was able to go straight into that SharePoint site, create an item, and immediately it was able to send me an email for that newly created list in that newly created SharePoint site. Finally, prior to working this all out with solution aware flows, I went down the route of also duplicating just the basic personal flows. That's possible too. You can do that using the admin flow actions, the get flow and the create flow. You can update the definition that you pull back from one of those actions and do exactly the same, supply the list GUID, update any URLs, etc. Now, the only downside to this method that I could see was that is that if you're looking to go down the route of solutions, you want to have parent-child, you need to use the web API. This particular set of actions will not work on solution-aware flows, or at least not when I tried it. And so that marks the end of the demonstration. We've learned how to create a duplicate parent flow using the web API. And of course, I've used Power Automate to call that REST API, but maybe you'll go down the route of using PowerShell or something else. But ultimately, hopefully you've enjoyed the demonstration, you've learned plenty, and if you haven't already, make sure you like and subscribe, and I look forward to seeing you again sometime soon. Thanks for watching. Cheers. Bye.